This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Finding Italy. Travel, Nation and Colonization in Vergil's Aeneid. KFB Fletcher. The University of Michigan Press, Ann Arbor. Introduction. Why directions matter. Aeneas delivers perhaps the most infamous line of the Aeneid, after Dido confronts him about his plans to leave Carthage and her. Having been asked by Dido if our love detained him, Aeneas responds that there are two places he would rather be. If he could choose, he would return to Troy, but he has been told by Apollo that he must go to Italy, of which he says, "This is my love, this is my fatherland." Aeneas' use of the term amor to refer to his goal makes any continued relationship with Dido impossible. But when he delivers this heartbreaking line to Dido, he has barely seen Italy and has not yet made it anywhere near his final destination. How, then, can he love Italy? Aeneas has fallen in love with the idea of Italy, a mental image that derives completely from the directions he receives over the course of the first half of the Aeneid. In some sense, the directions Aeneas receives to Italy are Italy, for they provide his only picture of his new patria. To use Benedict Anderson's famous definition of the nation, Italy is purely an imagined community for Aeneas, and this book examines the process by which Aeneas falls in love with Italy before even arriving there, and what this love means for both Aeneas and Vergil's audience. The mental image of Italy as a unified entity that forms over the course of the first half of the poem, and with which Aeneas falls in love, demands consideration, because of the context in which Vergil was writing, and the subsequent influence of the Aeneid on notions of Romanness. Vergil was writing at the tail end of what can only be considered an identity crisis for Roman Italy. In less than 60 years, the notions of Italy and Rome, and thus Italian and Roman, were challenged and significantly changed by a series of wars and their accompanying legislative developments. First, Rome fought against its long-standing Italian allies in the Social War, largely over the issue of Roman citizenship. While Rome won the war in military terms, the Italians ultimately gained Roman citizenship, meaning that almost overnight the number of Roman citizens increased drastically, and that citizens were spread across a much larger geographic area than had ever before been the case. Roman citizenship became less attached to the city of Rome itself, and connected more with Italy as a whole. The series of civil wars that followed the Social War again pitted Italians against Italians. At the same time, the number of Italians increased further, now through Julius Caesar's legislation. To reward his northern allies on the verge of war in 49, Caesar gave Roman citizenship to parts of northern Italy that were previously considered only marginally Italian or even Gallic, including Vergil's own home region of Mantua. After Caesar was assassinated, his adoptive son Octavian, later Augustus Caesar, fought against Caesar's former right-hand man, Marcus Antonius, in a war that ultimately led to the formation of what we call the Roman Empire. In the span of 60 years, Italy had expanded, and so had Rome. At the beginning of the 1st century BCE, there is no real evidence for a conception of a unified Roman Italy. By the time Vergil is writing, however, there is a clear sense that Italy is unified and Roman and somehow different from and more privileged than Rome's other holdings. And the idea of a unified Italy was central to Augustus' attempts to gain and maintain control. As he says in his political autobiography, written at the end of his life, "Of its own will, all of Italy swore allegiance to me, and demanded that I be the leader of the war in which I was victorious, near Actium. The provinces of Gaul, Spain, Africa, Sicily, and Sardinia also swore allegiance to me." This unity underlies the whole Aeneid, and while it is especially important in the poem's second half, the first half of the poem calls attention to the nature of Italy as a land full of various peoples. It is this crisis of identity, the notions of Italian and Roman, changing so much so quickly, that the Aeneid addresses, especially in its depiction of the Trojan journey. It is no surprise that such a series of events should give rise to a new myth of national origin, because such periods of radical change often give rise to new social narratives. As Kalami says in his study of Greek colonization myths, whether it is manifested materially in the form of oral or written narratives, social rituals, or figural or plastic representations, the symbolic process, we shall call it thus henceforth, seems regularly to be aroused by a singular occasion, decisive modification in the history, lifestyle, or ecology of the society in question, which also affects the emotional state of individuals. This modification provides the need for reflection, operating in contact with both empirical reality and the conceptual and cultural preconceptions and representations inherent in the society concerned, to construct a figurative response. The Aeneid is a response to the events of Vergil's lifetime and the preceding decades, a meditation on how things had changed and what those changes might mean for the people who comprised Vergil's audience and were part of this new nation. Vergil's depiction of the Trojan journey and the series of directions Aeneas receives respond to one of the key problems of this new era of Rome: how to create and form an attachment to one's new nation. The term nation is a problematic one, and with the related term, nationalism, the source of great debate among scholars of various historical eras. While many scholars of nationalism see it as a modern phenomenon, many of their definitions fit the circumstances of Augustan Rome very well, and certainly well enough that throughout, I will refer to Rome as a nation and examine the ways in which the Aeneid explores and contributes to the idea of Roman nationalism. Perhaps the most influential definition of a nation has been that of Benedict Anderson, who coined the term imagined community, defining the nation as a mental construct of its people, an imagined political community, imagined as both inherently limited and sovereign. While this idea has been criticized for a variety of reasons, some variation of it still underlies most scholarly formulations of the nation and is applicable to the Roman Empire under Augustus. But scholars of modern nationalism and Anderson in particular fail to address a central phenomenon in first century Rome: the fact that most people had multiple patriae or fatherlands. The clearest evidence for this phenomenon is found in the writings of Vergil's older contemporary, Cicero, who, like Vergil, was not from the city of Rome itself. At the beginning of the second book of Cicero's De Legibus, written and set in the late 50s, Atticus and Cicero are in Cicero's homeland, Arpinum, and have a discussion about place. 2. Atticus: before, therefore, I was amazed, since I was thinking that there was nothing in these places but rocks and mountains, and so I was led to do by your stories and your poems, but I was amazed, as I said, that you were so delighted by this place. Now, instead, I'm amazed that you're ever able to be away in Rome. 3. Marcus: I forbid myself to be away when I can get away for many days, especially at this time of year, and I pursue this pleasantness and healthfulness. It is rarely allowed, though. But it especially pleases me for another reason, too, and one for which it can't please you, Titus. Atticus: tell me, what is the reason? Marcus: well, to speak truly, this is my and my brother's Germana Patria. Here we were born of a most ancient stock, here are our holy places, here is our race, here there are many traces of our ancestors. What else can I say? You see this villa, as it now is, built in a more polished fashion by my father's care, who, since he was of ill health, spent most of his life here writing. But know that I was born in this very place when my grandfather was alive, and the villa was small in the ancient manner, like that Curian villa in the Sabine territory. Therefore there is something in it that hides in my spirit and my senses, such that this place pleases me more, if indeed even that most wise man is said to have given up immortality so that he might see Ithaca. 4. Atticus: I consider that a proper reason for you to come here with pleasure and to delight in this place. But I myself, should I speak truly, have now become more fond of that villa and of this ground on which you were born and created. For we are moved in some way by the very places in which there are traces of those whom we love or admire. Certainly, even my Athens does not delight me so much because of the magnificent and exquisite arts of its ancients, as much as because of the recollection of the greatest men, where each was accustomed to live, to sit, to argue, and I eagerly gaze even at their tombs. For that reason, from now on, will I love more the place where you were born. Marcus, I'm glad then that I have shown you my cradle, so to speak. 5. Atticus, certainly I'm very glad to have gotten to know it. But what was that thing you said a little bit before, that this place, by which I take it that you mean Arpinum, was your Germana Patria? Do you have 2 patriae, or is there 1 common patria? Unless by chance that famous wise man Cato's patria was not Rome, but Tusculum. Marcus, I think that he and all inhabitants of Municipia have 2 patriae, 1 by nature and the other by citizenship, as Cato, although he was born in Tusculum, was taken into the state of the Roman people, and so though by birth he was Tusculan, he was Roman by citizenship, he had 1 patria of place, another of law. As your Athenians, before Theseus ordered them all to leave the fields and move into what is called the Astu, were both their own people and Athenians, so we call our patria both the place where we were born and the place by which we were received. But it is necessary that the one from which derives the name of the republic for the whole state take precedence in love, as it is the place for which we ought to die, and to which we should give ourselves wholly, and in which we should place all that is ours, and so to speak to devote ourselves. But the one which bore us is no less sweet than the one which received us, and so I will never deny that this is my patria, although that one is greater and this one is contained in that. Cicero realizes that the existence of 2 patriae creates a problem, how to choose between them when the need arises. While Cicero is clear in saying that people must choose Rome, he passes over the challenge of developing this love of one's greater patria, the patria civitatis that incorporates one's patria natura. The first half of the Aeneid provides a narrative of how this love of the patria civitatis can form, for it is the story of how Aeneas comes to love Italy even more than Troy. Although Cicero does not explain how one can come to love the patria civitatis more than the patria natura, his language suggests the type of vocabulary we should look for in Vergil, most obviously the language of love, especially familial love. Cicero's language emphasizes the familial structure underlying the notion of the patria, clear from its connection with pater father, and his notion of a Germana patria differentiates the place of one's birth from the larger patria. In the former, you share both parents, so to speak, with those born around you, whereas you only share 1 parent with everyone who belongs to the larger nation. Troy is Aeneas and the Trojans' Germana patria, their patria natura, while Italy will be their patria civitatis, which must take precedence over their smaller patria, ultimately incorporated into the larger patria. The Aeneid explains how Aeneas' love of Italy surpasses his love of Troy even before he arrives at his destination in Italy, and why he will be willing to fight for it. As Cicero asserts, one has to be willing to die for one's patria civitatis, and so Aeneas, who ceases fighting and refuses to die for Troy, after some divine cajoling, will fight for his new patria in Italy. The Trojan journey dramatizes the process whereby Italy comes to have meaning for the Trojans and their Trojan descendants, and Aeneas' reasons for loving Italy are to be found in the directions he receives, for they are the source of everything he knows about Italy. As he learns more and more about Italy, Aeneas increasingly develops a connection with it, a process that culminates in the underworld in Book 6, when Anchises shows him his descendants and explains the glory of Rome that is to come. Unlike the other 2 great prophecies in the poem, Jupiter's words to Venus in Book 1 and the description of Aeneas' shield in Book 8, Anchises' tour of Aeneas' descendants is the only time someone explains to Aeneas at length in explicit terms what is at stake in his journey. This tour is the final part of the process of Aeneas falling in love with Italy, and it comes right before Aeneas reaches his destined spot in Italy, at which point he must fight for what has been ordained by fate. The directions Aeneas receives throughout the poem explain why he is willing not only to keep traveling, but also to fight upon arriving in Italy. The idea of the journey is central to the Aeneid, in part because Vergil depicts Italy as the ultimate destination, attracting gods, Greeks, and Trojans alike. The Trojans are only the last to arrive and are like the missing puzzle piece, They complete the mix of peoples that will create the Roman race, which is the true subject of the poem. Tante malus erat Romanum condir gentem. Of such great difficulty was it to found the Roman race. In the Aeneid, Italy as a whole is a land of exiles, foreshadowing the way in which Rome itself will be at its origin a place of asylum under Romulus, and then ultimately the center of a Mediterranean empire, open to all. The Trojan journey in the Aeneid highlights this centripetal motion and mirrors the creation of the nation. Anderson's discussion of religious journeys provides a useful parallel. For our purposes here, the modal journey is the pilgrimage. It is not simply that in the minds of Christians, Muslims, or Hindus, the cities of Rome, Mecca, or Benares were the centers of sacred geographies, but that their centrality was experienced and realized, in the stagecraft sense, by the constant flow of pilgrims moving towards them from remote and otherwise unrelated localities. The Italy of the Aeneid is a land of exiles, all connected by their coming together in the same geographic location. Aeneas' journey to Italy dramatizes the creation of this community, and the directions are a sort of blueprint for the foundation of the Roman race. Cicero again helps provide a way to think about Vergil's project by using the journey home as a way of forming a stronger bond with one's country. In another famous passage, Cicero says of Varro's antiquarian research, "For your books led us home, so to speak, traveling and wandering in our own city like foreigners, so that we could at last learn who and where we were." Like Vergil, Varro had discussed the origins of Rome, and Cicero's metaphor eloquently expresses the notion that learning about your country is a patriotic endeavor, that one way to become more Roman is to learn more about Rome. Cicero's metaphor is emotionally powerful, because few, if any, journeys are more fraught with meaning than that of homecoming, and there is arguably no stronger emotional tie to place than that which one feels with one's home. The emotional meaning of place and travel is the key focus of this book, as it examines how Aeneas develops his emotional connection with Italy. How, over the course of the first half of the Aeneid, does Aeneas come to think of Italy as home? Cicero's choice of metaphor is also apt because he, like most famous Roman writers, was not from Rome proper, but a nous homo from Arpinum. While the obvious implication of the metaphor is that these books make Cicero and his companions more Roman, in order for the books to do this, they must first do the opposite. They must make their readers aware of how much they are like foreigners in their own city. To some extent, Cicero was an outsider, needing instruction to become fully Roman. And there were more and more people like Cicero in Rome, especially in the mid-first century BCE, when the recent social war, followed by years of civil war, called into question the nature of both Rome and Italy. Written a couple decades after Cicero's treatise, Vergil's Aeneid responds to this same need for national self-definition through investigation of the nation's past. Much recent scholarship has focused explicitly on the Aeneid's connection with the formation of Roman national identity in the Augustan period, but none of these studies has gone far enough in seeing how the very plot of the Aeneid operates in the same way as Cicero's metaphor, and thus testifies to a pressing need at the time of the poem's composition that the poem itself helped meet. Vergil's decision to spend roughly half of the Aeneid on the Trojans' journey to Italy has the same effect that Cicero accords to Varro's books. It creates some distance only to remove a greater distance. The directions Aeneas receives introduce this distance by presenting Italy from Aeneas' foreign, outside perspective, and Vergil uses Aeneas' perspective to help make Italy less familiar to his audience, in large part through careful use of place names. Roman poets were well aware of the subtle resonances that different place names offered, and Vergil's use of antiquated and even invented names, such as Thybris for the Tiber River, creates a sort of double vision and enacts a certain displacement, rendering the familiar unfamiliar, like a writer's use of the name New Amsterdam would register with American readers both as New York City and something that is not quite New York City. Because directions focus specifically on place and often employ place names, they provide an ideal locus for an examination of the views of Italy Vergil gives to the Trojans, and through them, his readers. Much recent work on the Aeneid has focused on Roman identity, specifically on how it is portrayed, shaped, and challenged by the poem. Two books in particular have discussed the subject at length, Yasmin Syed's Vergil's Aeneid and The Roman Self, Subject and Nation in Literary Discourse, and J.D. Reed's Vergil's Gaze, Nation and Poetry in the Aeneid. Both books examine Roman identity in the Aeneid by focusing on the gaze, or how characters in the poem, and how we as readers through them, view the events of the poem. While Syed uses a primarily psychoanalytic approach to the gaze and Reed a narratological one, both highlight the importance of what, and how, the characters in the poem, especially Aeneas, see. Similarly, both highlight the multiplicity of gazes made available to the reader, though Syed emphasizes the poem's creation of a firm Roman identity with a lasting influence, while Reed's reading is more open-ended, showing how Roman identity is always provisional and perspectival, too. This book builds on these studies and others by focusing on another, less literal type of viewing in the poem, the view of Italy as a geographical destination. Specifically, it examines how Vergil portrays Italy to Aeneas, and in turn, to his own Roman audience in the first half of the poem, as Aeneas learns more and more about his destination and travels to it, falling in love with the idea of Italy on the way. Directions to a place are a description of the destination and thus contain some expectations of that destination, as is especially clear when Aeneas or other Trojans talk about the directions they have received. While it is perhaps a modern idea to talk of visualizing one's goal, the metaphor applies here because the directions Aeneas receives create an image of an Italy that does not technically exist yet, since these directions are not just about the Italy that exists in the years after the fall of Troy, but the Italy that will come to be and all of the Italies between. In turn, these directions offer Vergil's audience a view of what Italy can become and provide a glimpse of the imagined community that Italy will be under Augustus. The directions Aeneas receives to Troy are central to the aims of the Aeneid and have multiple purposes, so they need to be read multiple ways simultaneously. First, as part of a narrative, these directions have to have a certain plausibility, as they play a role in moving the story along. While we should not expect a completely accurate travelogue from an epic poem, the directions are a part of making the Trojan journey seem like a real, mostly believable journey. In their gradual revelation of information, these directions also provide a certain amount of suspense, leading the audience to wonder what Aeneas, and they, will learn next. In practical terms, the directions must also get the Trojans to Italy, and more particularly the exact spot at which they are supposed to be. Finally, and most important, these directions must make Aeneas care enough about Italy to keep struggling to get there, and to make him willing to fight for Italy when he arrives. These directions provide everything Aeneas knows about Italy, and they must make him love his new country. As the Trojans' destination, Italy is defined by the poem's main characters before any of them sees their promised land, and the identity of their new country shifts as they get closer to it and get more specific directions. The directions they receive create a picture of Italy that defines Aeneas' destination before he founds any city and provides the basis for the founding of the Roman race. This developing picture of Italy gives the Trojans something for which to fight in the poem's second half, while allowing Vergil's audience to see Italy and Rome through new eyes. Many of the passages containing directions are well known and oft examined, but I combine them in new ways and read them in ways that provide new insights into the poem on a basic level. First, however, it is necessary to say more about the framework of related conceptual areas within which we must discuss the Trojan journey. To understand the image of Italy that Vergil gives us, we need to understand the context within which his readers would view the journey. Discussing Aeneas' directions involves not only the abstract ideas mentioned already, but also the most practical question: how did Aeneas know how to get where he was going? Answering such a question is not as simple as it might at first seem, in part because we could apply to the whole poem what Nellis says of Book 3. Aeneid 3 is simultaneously an odyssey, a nostos, and a narrative of colonization. As with most questions we might think to ask of the Aeneid, we find ourselves asking not one question, but a series of questions that branch off one from the next, seemingly indefinitely. In this case, the question, why does Aeneas get the directions to Italy that he gets? Involves studying ancient geography, ancient travel, colonization narratives, prophecy, and even what the idea of wandering meant in the ancient world. Fortunately, we can apply good recent work on all these aspects of the ancient world to our study of the Aeneid. Space, geography, and the nature of ancient travel. Seafaring occupied a central place in the ancient world, both as the primary means of long-distance travel and as a source for metaphor. One aspect of this book is a treatment of the entire Trojan journey as a metaphor for the discovery and formation of identity, but more specific metaphors are also relevant to the present discussion. One example is the ship of state, which Vergil uses throughout the Aeneid, most clearly perhaps in Book 5, when the helmsman, Palinurus, falls overboard and Aeneas steers the ship to port in Italy. Also relevant is the connection between sailing and fortuna. Because of the difficulties of sailing under ancient conditions, especially the dependence on the weather, the success or failure of voyages was often associated with one's lot in life. As the Trojans leave Troy, for example, Father Anchises was ordering us to give our sails to the fates. Aeneas' success in sailing, then, is a part of his role as a man of destiny. But Aeneas' journey is not only a metaphor. Vergil narrates a largely realistic journey that could have taken place over areas the poet and his audience knew. To place Aeneas' journey, or more specifically, the description of his journey through directions, in its proper context, then, it is necessary to understand the nature of ancient travel, to consider the realities of geography, navigation, and travel in the ancient Mediterranean world, and to know what Vergil and his audience would have thought about and expected of such a sea voyage. Vergil was himself a veteran traveler, and the Aeneid abounds in navigational detail, which serves as a reminder that one of the marks of poetic greatness is the eye for such mundane detail and the ability to put it to poetic use. Such an examination of ancient travel and ancient notions of space does not mean, however, that we should expect Vergil to provide an accurate, scientifically correct travelogue, because he was, after all, writing a poem and working within a tradition of poems involving travel, including Homer's Odyssey and Apollonius' Argonautica, that influenced how he portrayed the travel in his own epic. But the journey in the Aeneid differs from other epic journeys, such as Odysseus, by having as its end point a city and not a house. It is also unlike Jason's journey, since it goes from the known to the unknown, with no return trip. This latter point raises a mundane but important issue. In the ancient world, how did one go from point A to point B without really knowing where, or what, point B was? Ancient geography was in many ways more conceptual than its modern counterpart, as much about the idea of a place as about the location of a place. For Aeneas to get to Italy, then, he also has to learn about Italy, a process that stands as a metaphor for the whole poem. The process of Aeneas learning where he is going provides the information he needs to fall in love with Italy. The ways in which Greeks and especially Romans traveled has recently received much-needed attention. Most relevant here is our more nuanced awareness of how Romans thought of directions and how they envisioned places. They seem not to have had scale maps, and to have tended to focus on places relative to other places and on the relative importance of places. At sea, they relied on the knowledge of the individual captain and on periploi, lists, or annotated sketches of cities in and around a body of water. Distance, when given at all, was usually expressed in terms of number of days, though this number was sometimes arbitrarily converted into an amount in stades. On land, itineraria served the same purpose, listing places in order, often noting the distances between successive locations. Both types of maps express space in simplified but useful ways, depicting journeys as a matter of connecting the dots. One could follow a periplus or itinerarium forward or backward and be relatively sure of where one was going. Difficulties could arise when travelers, like Aeneas, did not possess such materials. A passage from the medical writer Galen shows how the lack of basic information could disrupt a trip and offers a useful parallel for some of the difficulties the Trojans face on their trip. For when I was again making my way from Asia to Rome by foot through Thrace and Macedonia, instead I sailed to Lemnos from Alexandria Troas, having acquired there a ship which was going to Thessalonica. I made an arrangement with the captain to put ashore at Lemnos on the trip. And he carried out his duty, but not to the city which I wanted. For previously I did not know that there were two cities on the island, but believed that, like Samos, Chios, Cos, Andras, Tinos, and all the other islands in the Aegean, which all have a city of the same name as the whole island, Lemnos had one city of the name. As I disembarked, I learned that the name of the city was Myrinae, and that neither the temple of Philoctetes nor the sacred hill of Poseidon were in that region, but in another which is called Hephaestus, and that this city was not near Myrinae. And since the captain was not able to wait for me, I put it off, so that when I was returning from Rome to Asia I might see Hephaestus, and I did the very thing which I had hoped and proposed. For when I was crossing from Italy into Macedonia, and I had crossed almost all of it by foot, and I had arrived at Philippi, a city right next to Thrace, I descended from there to the sea, which at its closest point was 120 stades away, and first I crossed to Thasos, about 200 stades away, and from there into Lemnos, about 70 stades, and back into Alexandria Troas, about 70 stades. And I have written at such length about both the course and the stades, so that if the same desire of seeing Hephaestus that seized me seizes anyone else, the knowledge of its position will thus enable navigation. For in the whole island of Lemnos, Hephaestus looks to the east, and Marina to the west. Galen, and the captain, knows that there is an island named Lemnos and the rough general area of this island, but such knowledge is not enough. Upon the discovery of more information, Galen transmits it to make it available to others, suggesting the absence of more convenient places to look. Though it postdates Vergil, I quote this lengthy passage to give a partial view of how Vergil and his contemporaries could think of space and travel, and to suggest the framework within which Vergil constructed Aeneas' journey. Aeneas knows even less than Galen when he sets out from Troy, and has no captain who has made the trip before, and he must find the exact right spot in the much larger area of the Italian peninsula. It is no surprise that he gets off track at times. He has a constant need for new, more reliable information, and this process of constantly gaining and re-evaluating information provides Vergil the ideal way to provide more and more information about Italy. Fluid notions of space, and an at times impressionistic approach to geography, explain part of the narrative dynamics of Aeneas' continual tweaking of his directions from the vague to the specific. They also explain how Anchises and others can make mistakes about where they are going, especially since many of these directions are couched in prophecies, which are inherently ambiguous. Tied in with the description of space through maps, itineraries and periploi is the changing conception of space and the surrounding world. The idea of space is not just some fanciful poetic notion, but a key aspect of how polities conceive of themselves and others. As Nicolet phrases it, in his foundational study of space and geography in the early Roman Empire, the ineluctable necessities of conquest and government are to understand or to believe that one understands the physical space that one occupies or hopes to dominate, to overcome the obstacle of distance and to establish regular contact with the peoples and their territories. Aeneas' journey enacts a Roman domination of the spaces he travels. Every mile Aeneas covers on his journey is Roman territory under Augustus. Aeneas is surveying all the lands his descendants will control, and with each step, he learns more about Italy and forms a deeper attachment to it. Colonization narratives. Unlike the Odyssey and Argonautica, which tell the story of there and back kinds of adventures, the Aeneid narrates a type of journey into the unknown that is more mundane but no less dangerous. The voyage from metropolis to colony. Aeneas' mission to found a new city sets him on a path that helps determine a great deal in terms of how and why he gets the information he needs. As Doherty has shown, Greek colonization narratives follow certain patterns, and the Aeneid follows many of these patterns. Throughout this discussion, it will be useful to adduce parallels from other caitiasis, or foundation, narratives, though the use of these parallels should not be taken to mean that Vergil knew these particular stories. While our sources for these narratives are primarily Greek and involve Greek colonies, they would have been familiar to Vergil's audience from a wide range of literature, most obviously the genre of caitiasis poetry. And though this genre may not have come into existence until the Hellenistic period, stories of caitiasis appear long before that time in multiple genres, from epic to comedy to history. Even in the Hellenistic period, when we know that people like Apollonius were writing entire caitiasis poems, shorter caitiasis stories still appeared in works belonging to other genres, including Apollonius' own epic, Argonautica, which briefly tells the tale of the future foundation of Thera. Furthermore, Vergil and his audience would likely have known additional similar stories from closer to home, as most of the cities in southern Italy, being Greek colonies originally, would have had their own caitiasis stories. Vergil had ample parallels on which to draw, and could have expected this pattern to resonate with his audience. Doherty identifies a basic four-step pattern: 1. Civic crisis, 2. Consultation of Apollo's oracle at Delphi, 3. An oracle authorizing an overseas colony, 4. Foundation and resolution of original crisis, all memorialized through a cult of the founder. While I discuss how the Aeneid fits this pattern in greater detail in subsequent chapters, the basic fit is clear. 1. Troy falls, 2. The Trojans consult Apollo's oracle at Delos, 3. Apollo gives them an oracle telling them to go to Italy, 4. The Trojans arrive in Italy. Aeneas promises to found Lavinium, and Jupiter says that Aeneas will become a god. Vergil's use of this familiar pattern helps shape the narrative and engages readers' expectations while emphasizing the inevitability of the narrative's outcome. Underlying this colonization narrative is the belief that the gods have authorized the act of colonization. The gods tell Aeneas over and over that his future city in Italy belongs to him, and he and others often refer to what he and Aeneas are owed. Aeneas' belief that he owns this land even before arriving is central to Vergil's depiction of Aeneas' love of Italy. But the Aeneid differs from other colonization narratives because it is not about the foundation of a city, since Aeneas does not found Rome in the poem, even though such a choice was theoretically open to Vergil. The focus on Pater Aeneas allows Vergil to narrate a story that is not exclusively Roman, but is open to all Italians. A poem about Romulus, for instance, would have had less potential appeal to people outside the city, and possibly to Vergil himself. Neither does the poem revolve around the foundation of Lavinium or Alba Longa, though Vergil refers to these cities, both of which were associated with Aeneas by this time. Rather, he focuses on a broader concept, as he resoundingly announces at the end of the second proem. Of such great difficulty was it to found the Roman race. This final preliminary line simultaneously announces the point of the poem, and that Vergil has reinvented the notion of a caitiasis poem. As the preceding verse shows, it is a poem not about the foundation of a city, but about a gens, which I have translated as race, but which can also mean nation. Like the terms in Cicero's discussion of patria, gens has familial connections and is related to words involving birth and propagation. The radical nature of Vergil's departure is clear from a comparison with the titles of known caitiasis poems. Apollonius of Rhodes, for example, wrote poems called The Foundation of Alexandria, The Foundation of Cnidus, The Foundation of Naucratis, and The Foundation of Rhodes. An alternate title for the Aeneid could thus be The Foundation of the Roman Nation. Vergil's use of the adjective Romanus here exemplifies his care in applying place names and words derived from them, and demonstrates the central role of such words in the Aeneid. The application of Romanus to something from several centuries before the city of Rome was founded is anachronistic in one sense, but at the same time, this grammatical reversal, having the adjective predate the place name, proclaims a key truth behind the Aeneid. Romanness predates and thus transcends Rome. This adjective associates Aeneas with the city of Rome, but also shows that Rome is something more than a limited point in space. This use of Romanus is far from unique in the Aeneid, and is rather indicative of Vergil's general practice in the poem. As mentioned earlier, Vergil uses archaic and invented names to introduce distance between the world of the poem and his readers, and he also uses names as a way to show that identities in the poem are shifting, as most obviously when Aeneas visits the future site of Rome, and Evander tells him the history of the site, with each group of owners giving its own name to the land. Before Aeneas and the Trojans arrive in Italy, the identity of the inhabitants and of the land itself are in flux. The arrival of Aeneas and the Trojans sets in motion the inexorable march toward the stability of the Augustan Age, and the proof that this flux is stabilizing is that the Trojans start to create place names that survive to Vergil's day. This permanence is a sign of the Trojan success. Place names are also important in the poem because they are central to the logistics of travel, and they further play a key role in colonization, as the act of colonization usually coincides with the act of naming. In the Aeneid, the Trojans found several cities on the way to Italy, and most of them are given names that recall place names connected with Troy, such as Troia and Pergama. Only in Italy do the Trojans begin to use a new type of name, the personal names of people on the voyage, and thus begin permanently to affect their new home. Renaming a place is, in turn, a sort of refoundation. The act of naming, and who is doing the naming, is a key part of the Trojan journey. This kind of naming, often proleptic, is especially important in the Aeneid, because the only act of founding at the end of the poem is that of Aeneas burying his sword in Turnus' chest. Vergil's directions reflect the contingency of identity through the shifting names in the poem. Names carry a great deal of weight because they are the most obvious way of defining identity, or at least of trying to come to grips with identity. As Johnson remarks on Propertius grappling with similar issues in his fourth book, names are especially loaded within the context of the recent changes in Italy. And he knows, too, that even as Vergil's complex, conflicted image of a united and new Roman identity is coming into being, the people of Rome, both the old and the new, are Romans now in name only. They are all hybrids now. It is the empire, not the city, that matters, and the empire's center is now beginning to be ubiquitous. Propertius is certainly more playful in pointing out the incongruities in the new systems as they develop, but both he and Vergil are commenting on the same systems and grappling with the complicated emotions to which they give rise. Vergil's account of Aeneas' journey is one way of defining Italy, not least one suspects to himself. Vergil was from northern Italy, spent time in both Rome and Naples, and wrote at least part of the Aeneid in Greece, where he, too, had a chance to view Italy from the outside. Vergil's construction of the Aeneid, in large part as a caitiasis narrative, is thus not just a literary decision, adopted for narrative efficiency. The choice is central to his whole investigation of the question of what Rome means. Colonization narratives embody and work through key ideas about a group of people. Caitiasis poetry creates a past for a group of people through a connection with a place, or rather with multiple places. Caitiasis narratives always define a before and after, a here and there, an us of the now, as opposed to the kind of us then. These are complicated notions that give rise to complicated and often conflicting emotions, and without giving way to the temptation to read a 21st century sense of guilt into the literature of colonizers, ancient or modern, we should acknowledge that there rarely exists a simple view of the process of nation-building, and certainly not in the famously polysemous Aeneid. The situation is doubly complicated in this case because Vergil is not just writing about the origins of Rome and the Trojan battle with Italians. He is also writing within the living memory of the social war, in which Rome had fought with many of its Italian allies. Additionally, Vergil is writing after the Augustan settlement, a sort of refounding of Rome, an action that raises the question about what the foundation of Rome means or ever meant. The directions Aeneas receives to Italy are thus part of a new reimagining of Rome and Italy. As Johnson notes of Propertius' reference to the Aeneid in 2.34, he already knows enough of the epic that is taking shape to realize that one thing the poem will attempt is the imagination of Roman unity, the construction of a new Roman subjectivity into which non-Roman Italians will have been blended. Vergil is giving an outside look at their home, not just to the people in the city of Rome, but to all of the Italians who are now also Roman. And to give them this outside view, Vergil needs to take them back to the time at which the mixing of Italians and Trojans created the Roman race. While throughout this discussion my references to colonization narratives refer to the legendary tales associated primarily with Greek colonization, we should not think of colonization only as a mythical literary thing to Vergil and his audience, because they lived in a time of intense Roman colonization. The continuing Roman colonization of Italy, that is, the creation of Roman coloniae throughout the Italian peninsula, played a key part in the unification of Italy and ultimate Romanization of the peninsula. While under Julius Caesar and Augustus, Roman colonization increased throughout the Mediterranean, including perhaps most notably a colony at Carthage. While Roman colonization does not seem to have given rise to the same sort of literature and narrative patterns as Greek colonization did, its continuing importance at the time Vergil was writing means that colonization was part of the daily reality of his audience and leaves its mark on his description of Aeneas' journey of colonization. Prophecy. Directions are a type of information and so, like every type of information, must have a source. Because almost all of Aeneas' directions in the Aeneid come from divine or divinely connected sources like prophets and ghosts, we can classify them as prophecies, which means that it is necessary to understand the mechanics of prophecy in Ctesias' stories in general and in the Aeneid in particular to appreciate how the directions Aeneas receives are part of larger patterns and are related to various narrative concerns. Oracles play a key role in colonization narratives as they provide information, a goal, and the authorization to colonize. As Calami has suggested for Herodotus, so in the Aeneid do oracles give significance to narrative action, the stream of prophecies that Aeneas receives, all of which contain some kind of directions, make his journey more than the simple voyage of a group of people from one place to another. It is through prophecy, too, that Aeneas will realize when he has reached his ultimate destination. But Aeneas is not the only audience for these directional prophecies. He is the internal audience for this information, and Vergil's readers are the external audience. Prophecy allows Vergil to convey an image of Italy simultaneously to Aeneas and to his contemporary audience. Like the place names they often contain, these prophecies allow Vergil's audience to see Italy through different eyes. In outlining what he calls optimistic prophecy, a prophecy that does not tell the listeners in the poem the full story, O'Hara has attempted to systematize how Vergil presents prophecies in the poem. Two of O'Hara's observations are especially relevant to a discussion of the directional prophecies. 1. Prophecies are a type of rhetoric, which means that speakers tailor what they say in part to fit what their audience wants or needs to hear. And 2. Prophecies in part work in a cumulative fashion and so are about creating a series of impressions. Aeneas' directions are shaped to his needs and meant to fit his mood. While I do not view the motives behind the directions with the suspicion O'Hara levels at prophets and gods generally in his study, I agree that the prophecies rhetorically tell Aeneas what he wants or needs to hear in order to be confident enough to continue on his mission. They are also like speeches, shaped to fit Aeneas' situation and knowledge. I also differ from O'Hara in taking his second observation about the cumulative effect of prophecies, as a reminder that we should not worry overly much about apparent contradictions. Aeneas gets various pieces of information as he goes, and adds them to his store as he receives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.